welcome to our special SummerSlam episode of WWE The Bomb, presented by Welch's 100% Grape Juice, the perfect tag team in celebrating SummerSlam, the last hurrah before it's back to school. This has been a huge weekend so far. NXT TakeOver last night, obviously SummerSlam today, and I got to bring on my friends to talk about it all. So please welcome Matt Camp, Evan T. Mack, and Ryan Popola.
It's SummerSlam, guys.
I saw the show
it's
coming.
SummerSlam.
Kayla Braxton.
Yeah. There we go. Got that energy from T-Mac. Like I said, we've got a big SummerSlam to look forward to tonight. But there was this little event that took place last night called NXT TakeOver 30. So we want to do something a little bit different here for a moment and show you guys watching how these guys reacted. Oh, these guys. Let's go this way. These guys reacted to some of their favorite NXT moments that took place last night. Take a look.
I kind of lost my mind.
Bob! Wow! That was awesome! Wow! Wow! Congrats to Damian Priest. That was amazing.
I don't have the words for exactly what happened. I'll do my best. The match literally just ended. Velveteen Dream got chucked into next August. Johnny Gargano got one over on Cameron Grimes, but then Damian Priest got one over on him to become the champion. And just literally so many things. But Damian Priest, who's been one of absolutely bar none the biggest rising stars in NXT for months now, longer than that, quite frankly, is the new NXT North American champion. Long may he reign. Well deserved.
I'll see you, baby. This has gone on long enough with Pat McAfee. Pat McAfee showed up. He showed up. I give him that. Moonsaults and whatnot. Panama Sunrise! It's Academic 3. Let's go! Mr. Bang Bang. Let's go. Enough's enough, man.
Well, guys, Io Shirai is still your NXT Women's Champion after defeating Dakota Kai, but with all that went down with Raquel Gonzalez and Rhea Ripley coming out at the end, I feel like there's so much more to this. I can't wait for Wednesday.
Whoa. Oh. Oh.
He got him. It's not a limitless reign for Keith Lee. Karrion Kross is the new NXT champion, and good luck to the rest of NXT, because I don't think that title is coming off his waist for a very long time. Wow.
Okay, I think it's safe to say that you guys clearly enjoyed TakeOver last night.
Yes, we did.
I liked it.
Absolutely.
It was cool.
Okay, let's turn our attention back to what's happening tonight. SummerSlam. We'll never see it coming. It is a stacked card. But I do want to first chat about the WWE Championship match between the Viper, Randy Orton, and the WWE Champion, Drew McIntyre. Fellas, what are your predictions, Camp? Let me start with you.
Drew McIntyre, from winning the Royal Rumble to defeating Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania and Big Show and Dolph Ziggler and Seth Rollins and Bobby Lashley. And now we get here. But it always felt like any time that Drew was heading into a title defense, he always had the upper hand. He was always locked in. Nobody could shake him. I don't feel that way right now. I think Randy Orton has gotten exactly where he wants to get with Drew McIntyre. He's got him worried about Ric Flair and Shawn Michaels and not his championship. I love Drew McIntyre. We love the man. But Randy Orton is taking his WWE championship from him tonight.
Wow. All right. Now,
that's spicy. What up,
buddy? What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, man, it's crazy in these streets, man. You know why? Because I love Randy Orton, man. He has a warm place in my heart, man. I got several Randy Orton shirts from WWE shop. Shout out to the shop.
Shout out to the shop.
Let me tell you something right now, Randy, man. Drew McIntyre's in his bag, man. He's in his bag of goodies, man. A la Santa Claus, man. He's all up in there spreading out claymores, giving them, kissing people under the mistletoe with that claymore. You know what's very interesting to me? I have to hold my feet to the fire, and I have to go with Drew McIntyre. Tonight, he will get it done. It will not be easy. It will be emotional. It will be the hardest match of his career.
I agree with that.
But he will win tonight.
Fair. Wow. Well, thank you, gentlemen. That is going to be an exciting match to watch go down. But another one that I want to talk about is the Raw Tag Team Championship match. The Street Profits will be defending against Angel Garza and Andrade. It was really good to see Montez Ford back in fighting shape this past Monday night on Raw. Evan, let me start with you. Considering what we did say on past Monday, how do you feel this match is going to go?
It's very interesting, very talented competitors. I had the pleasure of giving a quick chit-chat with old Montez Ford. More focused than I've ever heard him. Best shape of his life. This is the moment. Same with AD. Angel Garza and them, they won't have enough for the Street Profits. The Street Profits retain their titles. Montez Ford's too focused. AD's too focused. It's going to be academic tonight.
So I want to say that I'm going to take all personal feelings out of this. And Kayla, obviously, we're going to address that in a minute with you. But and I'm going to take as much personal feeling out of it as I can. However, I just got to be honest. Zelina Vega is about to come on this show. And so I'm taking Andrade and Angel Garza to win the Raw Tag Team title.
You're a smart man, Ryan, because I think I'm going to do the same thing. And there's a lot going on here, right? Wow. There's lots of drama. There's maybe some poisoning going on. Angel Garza has a lot of people that like his company, I guess, or whatever you want to say. But Zelina Vega always has a plan. And I think that maybe right now the Street Profits and Bianca Belair, maybe their mind is clouded by revenge or rage and not about defending those Raw Tag Team titles. So what's going to happen? Well, I'm also going to be smart like Ryan, because coming up right now, my pick to be the new Raw Tag Team Champions, along with Zelina Vega. They're going to join us right now. Kayla, I don't know you. I know you just don't want any part of this. Ryan and I'll take care of it. No problem. Hey, we got to be broadcast journalists. So right now, let's welcome in the future Raw Tag Team Champions, Andrade, Angel Garza, and Zelina Vega.
Hello. Good morning.
Thank you for being with us. Now, it is myself and Ryan doing this interview. Zelina, before we get into all of it, I have to address that because our co-host, Kayla Braxton, had a message specifically for you on social media as to why she's not part of the interview. So let's take a look at that right now.
Zelina, I don't even know what to say right now. Clearly, you were on The Bump, the show that I host, and I had to remove myself from your interview because I can't in good conscience sit down and have a cordial interview with someone who allegedly, but most likely, poisoned another WWE superstar. That is Montez Ford. Like, how low can you possibly go? Now, I get that you were on The Bump today. My broadcast colleagues are taking, you know, the reins of this interview because they do have to do their journalistic duty ahead of SummerSlam tonight, but I had to remove myself, Zelina. Like, you and I have had our issues. I get that. I started to think maybe I was seeing a new side of you. Maybe Zelina Vega has a heart. Well, clearly, you proved me wrong and everyone else. I hope you're able to look in the mirror. Hope you're able to sleep at night knowing what you did. I am very disappointed in you. And that's pretty much all I have to say. So I'm sorry. I am not sorry. I'm sorry that I'm not sorry for being on this interview with you today. Shame on you.
Zelina, she's done. She's done, yeah. Before we get to what we may have seen on Raw, what is your response to Kayla?
Well, first of all, I could look in the mirror and be, have you seen me? Like, hello? Yeah, I can look in the mirror and feel absolutely fine. But, I mean, she's acting as if her removing herself was like, oh, no, not the fact that she, like, removed herself, as if I'm going to be heartbroken about it. I'm glad she's here. I asked for her to not be here. So, I mean, in reality, I'm kind of happy about it. And if she's talking about poisoning, I didn't poison anybody. That video didn't show anything but the fact that I have a great jacket. And I was just fixing my top. That was it. But you can't see that from that angle.
I understand. That's the thing. We're going to take a look at the footage here now. And I'm with you because I've watched this from every possible angle.
Same.
As we look at this here, the footage from Raw, what we saw, the intent or the thought here, Can you give us any response as to what may happen? It may be happening. I do see a crown there as well.
There's a lot that could be happening.
I mean, regardless, I was just looking around, protecting it. I was fixing my top. It had nothing to do with the cup, nothing. I didn't even realize it was there, to be honest with you. But if Kayla wants to be on the poison list, she could absolutely be on the poison list.
Wow. I will forego that. I want to follow up, though. Assuming your innocence, Zelina, have you considered taking legal action? Because your name has been slandered if you are innocent. Is legal action a possibility?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Not only have I been, my name has been slandered, but I've been beaten up for no reason. Bianca Belair came after me for no reason multiple times. So, I mean, this is ridiculous.
Angel, you seem to have the attention of Demi Burnett and Charlie Caruso. Is it difficult to be that in demand?
It is. It is a little bit like being with one woman, then with another one. It's kind of hard, but not impossible.
This going on here with Charlie and Demi, does that take your attention away from tonight's task at hand, which is to bring home the Raw Tag Team Championships?
No, of course not. Of course not. That is just part of my day. I know how to separate that, how to separate the thing that happens in backstage and the thing that happens in the ring. So there are two separate things. I'm going to be focused when I'm on the ring in the Raw Tag Team Champions. And when I'm on the backstage, I need to be like kind of flirting. When I'm on the ring, I need to be professional. So there are two different things.
Sure.
Two big different things.
You have to be flirting. I understand.
He needs to.
It's a centering focus. Understood. Andrade, though, kind of branching off that, you're the only one without any of these, let's say, extracurriculars going on right now. I don't want to say drama, but, you know, things going on. Would you say you feel that as a unit, you, Andrade, you feel prepared for this match tonight?
I am a good boy.
I'm also good.
I am Angel Andrade.
I think that's a yes.
Oh, I'm so ready for tonight. I'm so ready. Yeah. This opportunity is for the Latinos, you know. It's my opportunity, the opportunity of the Angel. It's the opportunity number three, the Angel, my second time. And this title have a many history. I mean, the last Latinos had the titles is Eddie Guerrero and Rey Mysterio. Yeah. Nice first moment. I'm so excited for tonight, and we will win the titles tonight.
Branching off that, and clearly the focus is there, but we have seen for Angel and Andrade, for both of you, we have seen some tension at points between you two this summer, and you've addressed it over the recent weeks. Would you say that's firmly a thing of the past heading into tonight?
And why we cannot say that it's part of the plan?
Fair.
See? Everything in this business in between the three of us, a plan can be the reality, so you never know what we're gonna do. That makes sense?
Absolutely.
Okay, so we are business, we are wrestlers, we are everything using one.
Well, Zelina, obviously you know what you're doing. You always have a plan, but how do you deal with the presence of Bianca Belair? You did address it earlier that she's been after you a little bit. It's gotten quite physical as of late. The poisoning thing, whatever that may be. Do you have a plan to neutralize Bianca Belair tonight?
I do, actually. But I can't talk about it because I know that she watches my every move. So I'm going to just let her have that. She thinks that she's got this on live. That's fine. She's gotten me caught off guard a few times, and that's fine. But I won't have my time. And honestly, when it comes to Bianca, I'm becoming less and less worried about that problem.
And Zelina, you know, in relation to Bianca, really at this point, heading into this match tonight, the three of yours conflict with the Street Profits has basically, in a lot of ways, been going on all year long. It's really been from the duration of January to today. Just how big is this moment for you tonight? Is the gravity of that, you know, having this basically year-long journey so far, possibly culminating tonight, how much does that resonate with you?
The thing is, the Street Profits are irrelevant. The only reason that they matter to us is because they have the Raw Tag Team titles for now. And again, that could be on anybody. It's just, they want the smoke, that's fine, but we want the Raw Tag Team titles. I've said it numerous times, and we're not gonna stop, and we're not gonna come off their neck until we get it. So again, when it comes to them, we're not worried. This is something that we've been chasing for so long. It's time that we do this as a team. We are together, we're united. this is the, we've never been more on the same page than we are right now.
Off of that, though, and I say this with all due respect, there are, of course, scenarios that could result in you guys not walking out with the Raw Tag Team titles tonight. If that is to happen, what would be next?
We don't have a plan B. We don't have a plan B.
Just a plan A, and that's it.
Fair.
Let me throw this out there, because... Of course, you can hold more than one title. Andrade, you've been NXT champion. You've been United States champion. Angel, we have seen you as the Cruiserweight champion. Would there be any thoughts? Andrade, I'll start with you. After you win the Raw Tag Team titles tonight, would you have your eye on maybe regaining the United States championship, going after the WWE championship, as you are a former singles champion, as I said before?
No, I'm thinking for this night. I'm thinking for the protecting titles. I am focused. Maybe tomorrow, when tonight, enjoy the title and we take the picture together. Maybe tonight, think about it. Oh, what is next? For now, I'm just thinking in one goal.
Now, Angel, I'll throw that out to you. We have seen you as a Cruiserweight champion before. This would be your first tag team championship reign if it were able to happen. But do you have your eye on anything else or maybe anyone else?
Probably after the match, just take the Raw tag team title and then go with Demi, go with Charlie, take some pictures, and that's it. I'm thinking on that. Like, after my match, that could happen.
Take a photo option, you have them. It's a good move.
Selena, don't be jealous. Also with you.
First of all, there's no such thing with jealousy when it comes to me. However, just like Andrade had a little bit of, you know, his focus shifted before I came along in NXT, sometimes I got to reel you back because you're getting a little crazy. I got to reel you back a little bit.
Smile a little bit.
Okay.
And we appreciate all three of your time. But before we let you go, Zelina, final words. Any final words on this match tonight and or to Kayla Braxton?
Kayla, again, I'm so glad that you decided to remove yourself from the situation, mostly because the only frustrations I've had is the person with the – I don't even remember your name, something with the Sasha Banks shirt. But, Matt, you're awesome. And I'm so glad that we were able to do this. And I'm looking forward to coming back on the bump with my Raw Tag Team Champions next to me. And who knows? I mean, they're dripping gold. He's dripping gold. Maybe I will at some point. Who knows? But right now we're focused on tonight. We're focused on winning the Raw Tag Team titles, and it is about time.
Well, we want to thank all three of you for joining us. Lena, as always, my pleasure. It's all my pleasure.
Well. Well.
And also, good luck to Angel. Good luck to Andrade on bringing home the Raw Tag Team Championships tonight when you face the Street Profits at SummerSlam. Thank you, everybody.
Thank all three of you.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
That Zelina Vega is something else, guys.
We handled that well,
thank you for handling. I appreciate you handling that. Sure. By the way, who just keeps a mirror by themselves other than someone as egotistical as Zelina Vega?
Hey,
like, by them. Whatever. Best of luck to the Street Profits tonight. I hope you retain. Now, moving on. For the last several weeks, we've been asking you, the WWE Universe, to let us know your favorite SummerSlam moments of all time using the hashtag Best of SummerSlam. And we have now chosen the top four. So here is the number four SummerSlam moment presented by Cricket Wireless and World of Tanks.
The following contest is a triple threat match for the SmackDown Women's Championship.
Becky has got to be the aggressor. Now going up to the top turnbuckle.
Oh,
a
double drop kick.
Whoa, and a spear. Carmella's tied up. Becky, drop to Charlotte. Cover. And Carmella breaks it up.
The champ thinking about a Hail Mary.
Well, it's Rose. The queen about to go airborne. Takes out everyone. Now. Danger again, center of the ring. This coming up for Carmella.
Here comes Charlotte.
Natural selection. Cover. Charlotte Flair is a seven-time champion.
Each one of these ladies had to know this was going to happen. One of them would not walk out
here.
You
can't plan for true emotion, though, and it's going to be tough.
Oh, Becky! Becky, what? Lynette's your best friend!
Come on, Becky. Come on, Becky.
Apparently, Becky Lynch had reached her breaking point. This was about the title here tonight. That is what she came here for, and it was taken from her.
Becky Lynch lost her golden opportunity to her best friend.
Aye, aye, aye.
Oh, I remember that moment so well. That's when it just like all got crazy. Before they were sipping tea together, and then that happened. Big shout out to Sean R, who sent in that for his pick. This is what he had to say on the old Twitter. There you go. And Ryan, I want to start with you, your reaction to that being our number four pick.
So there's a lot there with it, right? And I think that the most important aspect of it is obviously everything that Becky did, but it's also the catalyst that literally leads us to the first ever women's main event in WrestleMania history at WrestleMania 35. However, I'm confident that Matt and Evan are going to cover the historical and the gravity of that moment. So I just want to say that Carmella gear is some of the greatest of all time. I guess that is just top-notch stuff, but you cannot underestimate or understate the importance of that moment.
Well said, brother.
No doubt about it, Ryan. And that, to me, that's the night, and the tweet kind of alluded to it. That's the night the man was born. I included this on the Bump Instagram for some recommendations that you could check out for on the free version of the WWE Network. But the fans were behind that, whether it was right or not, that Becky attacks Charlotte after she won the championship. That was the night everything started. To Ryan's point, that is why we ended up with the WrestleMania main event the next year being Becky, Ronda, and Charlotte. And that is why the man is where she is today. I hope the man's doing well, by the way. I heard she's writing a book.
She's doing her thing, man, enjoying her time. And it's very interesting to see that over again and realize that was the moment where women could main event WrestleMania and women can go on to main event anything and women can go on and have their own pay-per-view. And it's one of those things where I love that match for so many reasons because it was a darn good match. Shout out to Carmella's gear. Shout out to every single thing that represented. And it staked the claim of the women that they're here. They're here to stay. And they can do anything that the guys can do, if not better.
Absolutely. Anything we can do, you can do, we can do better. That's the whole thing. All right. Let's talk about some more matches that are taking place tonight at SummerSlam. How about the Universal Championship match? Braun Strowman, The Fiend, Bray Wyatt, Matt Camp. Let's just get right to you. What do you think?
Braun has gone somewhere. Maybe he's never gone before because of The Fiend, and I think that's exactly what The Fiend wants. Braun may think he's in control. He is not. Once again, your Universal Champion after tonight will be The Fiend.
Oh, yeah, it's a wrap. Right. It's a wrap. The Fiend got this one locked up. He's been leaning on Braun, and now the Tower of Braun will fall.
That's bold, Evan. That's bold, Matt. I tend to agree with the logic that typically when The Fiend brings his opponents to this place that they struggle. That is the track record. But for whatever reason, Braun just seems even levels beyond where most typically have fallen or risen to, depending on how you want to look at it. The Fiend wants this, right? So that does conclude that I should pick The Fiend, but I'm not gonna. For whatever reason, I just have this hunch that Braun Strowman, as much as I really despise his actions as of late, give me the monster among men. You'll see it coming tonight, Fiend. Whoa. Maybe.
Well, talking about despising actions, I'm going to come right back to you for Paul to talk about the street fight between Dominic Mysterio and Seth Rollins.
Yeah, I really hope The Fiend doesn't see what I just said. But in terms of this, tonight, Dominic, we talked to earlier this week. What a great kid. Man, watching this back is just still really tough. But I think because of this and so many other factors that I lean towards Dominic Mysterio tonight, as crazy as that may sound to some, it would be the biggest upset in SummerSlam history. But the variables and the pride of the Mysterio name, I think, lead Dominic to a victory tonight. And it would legitimately be one of the greatest and biggest victories in SummerSlam history.
Wow, I couldn't agree more, Pat. We had him on the show, had the pleasure of interviewing this young man. He's very polite, very well-spoken, well-mannered, but this is about his father. This is about avenging his father. This is about representing the Mysterio name, and I don't think he's going to fall short tonight. As crazy as it sounds, with his father in his corner in a street fight, anything can happen. I got Dominic Mysterio tonight.
We're really picking against Seth Rollins here, one of the most decorated champions in WWE. You may not like his actions, but this is one of the very best we have ever seen, and maybe the very best right now in WWE. I am very happy that Dominic is now part of the roster. I'm happy he signed two contracts. He is going to put up a heck of an effort tonight because of what happened to his father. But Seth Rollins is winning this matchup. Maybe, maybe he'll show a little bit more respect to the Mysterio family. But no matter what happens, Seth Rollins is winning tonight.
Matt hates happy endings.
Well, one thing we can all agree on, it's going to be an exciting night. And we've been talking about memorable SummerSlam moments. So it's now time to bring on an iconic superstar who can talk about some of his iconic SummerSlam moments. It is our Superstars of Summer segment presented by Welch's 100% Grape Juice, the perfect tag team partner to celebrate SummerSlam, the last hurrah before it's back to school. Please welcome on WWE Hall of Famer Mark Henry and his two beautiful children, Jacob and Joanna. Hello. Welcome to the bump, guys. Joanna, you have a beautiful smile. Both of you do. Actually, let me move my little frame. Both of you have, yes, the prettiest smiles. And we're going to talk about wrestling with you guys. But before we do, SummerSlam is around the corner, which means it's almost time to go back to school. So, Jacob and Joanna, what grade are you guys in? And be honest, are you ready to go back?
Well, I'm going to be a freshman, so I'm going to high school. And I'm actually looking forward to going back to school, to me, to be honest.
Good.
I am going into fourth grade, so I'm excited. Wait, no, I'm going into fifth grade now. So I'm not sure if I'm ready for that.
That's okay. Joanna, I always take a year off of my age. So you know what? I completely get it. I'm with you, girl.
So what did you guys do for this summer to stay active? And did you drink your Welch's to quench your thirst? And to get out of that summer heat, was a little Welch's on your mind?
The more we worked out, you know, it's just you get thirsty, you get dehydrated, and then this beautiful, perfect Welch's, 100% juice. And it's smooth like silk going down your throat.
It is clear who your father is.
Mark, speaking of that, absolutely, you got it, baby. When you were thinking of your youth and drinking Welch's grape juice, do you get any of that nostalgia? Does it come rushing back when you're drinking that silky smooth Welch's grape juice?
Most definitely. My mom was always one that bought Welch's 100% grape juice, and it's just one of those tastes that just makes you smile on forever.
Awesome. Well, Mark, let's talk SummerSlam. Now, your SummerSlam history is pretty interesting because it always seems like that moment that just propels you further into your career. Example, SummerSlam 1998. You're the corner man for The Rock in his legendary ladder match against Triple H for the Intercontinental title. Now, you played a big role in this match, possibly up until this point. It was one of your most high-profile moments. What do you recall the most about this night?
I was just happy that I didn't have to go up on the ladder. the best part of it. I got to go down, and I didn't have to get nowhere near that ladder. I'm afraid of heights.
Wow. So, after that ladder match, the Nation of Domination slowly begins to disband, and you morph into old sexual chocolate. Will you get to show off your charisma and your ability to entertain? Would you say your time with the Nation of Domination around like Ron Simmons, The Rock, Godfather, D-Lo, you think that helped you break out of your shell a little bit?
You know what, man? To be around all of those guys and Owen and Teddy Long, like it was like masterclass, you know? So nobody had a choice but to be better after we disbanded. And if you notice, everybody had success.
Mark, the next year, we're going to find out that you're going to get your first championship in WWE because you help Jeff Jarrett defeat D'Lo Brown for both the European and Intercontinental Championships. Of course, the next night on Monday Night Raw, Jeff, because of what you do right there with his guitar, is going to gift you the European Championship. How did you feel about the way you got your first championship in WWE?
A win is a win, pin me payment.
Nope.
is whether by hook or by crook, pro wrestling has always been. It's always been one of those things that you take what's given, and you sometimes you gotta just go with the flow.
And you have it forever, of course.
And that may be answering, you know, my next question. We talked about back in 98, the ladder match you were a part of, but not competing in, also same for 99. Did it bother you that you were actually competing in those matches? I mean, maybe not because you said you were afraid of heights. You wanted no part of getting up on that ladder anyway. Were those learning experiences for you, though?
They were learning experiences. And also, I was a, you know, very valuable piece in the end of those matches because, you know, whether you're the manager, whether you're the good guy or the bad guy, if you're in the match, then you have a purpose. And
yep.
I use my purpose to be memorable and have moments where people remember you. And I think I did that.
Before we skip ahead too far, I figure we could all just have a drink if you want to take a sip. That's what I'm doing. I know it's hot down there by you guys, so I'm sure you could use it. Go ahead.
Jacob. I jumped the gun. I was going
to. I mean, Jacob, you're about the size of your dad over there. You should just drink out of the bottle at this point.
Kayla, don't give him any ideas, please.
He's old enough to take a drink, but, you know, I'd rather just give it to him.
Yeah, there you go. What a good dad. Perfect.
Oh,
cheers all around there before we move on. So, Mark, in 2008, you defend the ECW championship. And even though it's a few years prior to the Hall of Fame really blowing up, that night, is that when it really got started, when you were in ECW and were the ECW champion? Because to me, that's kind of what it felt like when it was really the kickoff to what became you in the Hall of Fame.
It definitely did. Learning how to be a champion is a hard process because you have to be reliable, you got to be there every day, and you got to be able to show up and make sure that you're the first one there and the last one to leave. And I've learned a lot being champion. The people that I worked with were all elite. So you can't help but get better if you're around the cream of the crop.
No doubt.
To 2011, you have a really hard-hitting match against Sheamus. It's your last pay-per-view match before defeating Randy Orton to become the World Heavyweight Champion the following month. Could you feel your momentum building as you defeated Sheamus that night? Did you think it was only a matter of time?
I did. I definitely did. And that was, I guess I had the quote that if I start charging for air, keep your bill paid. And Sheamus brought the best in me out. And this is actually one of my favorite, if not my favorite, SummerSlam matches.
Well, I mean, looking at this, you said it's one of your favorite SummerSlam matches. Where does Sheamus rank on hardest hitters you've ever squared off against?
Wow.
Ooh. I think that was the most impactful SummerSlam match because it set the tempo. And I had other ones that were great, but that was the first one. And, you know, sometimes, you know, the first impression is the last one.
Now, Jacob and Joanne, a question for you guys, and I'll start with you, Jacob. Do you ever go back and watch some of your dad's old matches on the network? What are your thoughts when you see the younger version of old dad in the ring?
I love watching the Hall of Pain. It's very interesting. Watching him win the world championship was probably one of the greatest things that ever happened to me in my childhood. And it's kind of when I started to develop my love for WWE and wrestling. But I just try to stay away from that sexual chocolate stuff. That is one thing I am making sure I am not watching. Anything from 1999 to 2001, Vince says Mark Henry's involved, and I'm going to exit that from the WWE Network. I'm not watching
that. Jacob, I love you. You have such a big personality. You are incredible. Joanna, okay, I'm asking the same question to you now. Do you go back and watch your dad, or do you have like a favorite moment from watching your dad wrestle?
Watch my dad when he was younger. It's kind of weird seeing him with hair. I mean, it's really weird because if you look at him now and didn't look at him when he had hair. It's just.
Let's get to the top of your mind, your thoughts this year, your show, and let's start with two men you are very familiar with Randy Orton and Drew McIntyre. Who do you like, sir?
You know, it's hard for me to put anybody above Randy Orton. He's getting in that conversation now, being one of the top five greatest wrestlers of all time. But I am a Drew McIntyre fan. And after Monday night, seeing Randy Orton talk so bad to Ric Flair, I want to see Drew McIntyre put him in his place.
So as one of your all-time great big men yourself, where do you land on Braun Strowman and The Fiend, Bray Wyatt, sir?
Braun is coming into his own. If you watch them, this new anger and aggressiveness fits him. And I hope that he continues that, because that will take him into that category of the biggest strongman of all time.
And I don't want to interrupt, but I agree with you, because The Fiend, he's super powerful. And, you know, you see The Fiend looking at Braun in that scene, you know, The Fiend's laughing. The Fiend is enjoying it. He's liking this side of Braun Strowman. So you don't know what's going to happen this Sunday at SummerSlam. Like, The Fiend might be able to, he might enjoy Braun being in this situation, because he's just going to snatch him up and take it from him right then and there.
Wow. I can see that.
I'm with you.
Yes.
Let's talk about Asuka, because she has an opportunity to win not one, but two championships. She'll face Bayley for the SmackDown Women's Championship first. Then she'll face Sasha Banks for the Raw Women's Championship happening tonight. Mark, as you think of, and I don't know how many times you had this happen yourself, the thought of wrestling not only two matches in one night at a SummerSlam, but both with championships on the line. How would you approach this, Mark, if you had such an opportunity or multiple opportunities as Asuka does tonight?
You know, it's going to be an endurance thing. I think that she needs to attack, and attack in that first match. Try to end it quickly.
Yep.
And if it doesn't happen for you, then hey, then chalk it up. I tried to get it done quick, so you'll have something left for that second match.
So someone else who's been involved in some big moments without even stepping into the ring is Dominic Mysterio, and you know, he's had the spotlight on him long before his first match taking place here tonight. Now, do you think that's an advantage for Dominic, that the spotlight has already been on him for so many years?
You know, it's always good to be acclimated to the experience and the nerves, because JoJo was nervous about coming on. She was nervous. I think that'll help him, because he's been there and done that with his dad. But Seth Rollins is one of the best wrestlers in the world right now. I don't really see how he has a chance unless he knows something that I don't know.
Yeah, Seth is he's on a rampage. He's just doing things to people that you don't want to see happen to anybody, good or bad. And I love the Monday Night Messiah. I believe in him. I love his preaching. But, man, Dominic, these second and third generation superstars, we gotta keep it tight. We gotta stay together, man. We gotta keep it together.
Mark, your advice has been invaluable for so many of our superstars. We know you've talked to a lot of them and helped them throughout the years. I don't know if you've spoken to Dominic, but we talked to him earlier this week here on The Bump. He's ready to go. If you had any advice for him heading into SummerSlam tonight, what would it be?
Don't fall for the trap. He needs to go by the beat of his own drum. If he can go out there with passion, whether he wins or loses, he put up a good fight. And I think that's what's important for somebody like Dominic, this is his first venture into this bigger stage, into a stage this big. I just want him not to fall for the okey-doke.
Mr. Henry, the Hurt Business is on the show today. What have you seen from this faction that you like so far?
You know what? MVP has really stepped into his own. As far as, he reminds me a lot of Bobby the Brain Heenan. He can talk, and he can walk the walk. And it's good to see him in that spot. Bobby Lashley being the guy that is the heater. I see more from Bobby than I see from anybody in her business. Shelton Benjamin, as great as he is, and as great as MVP has been doing, I think I can see Bobby Lashley in that main event against Drew McIntyre, against Randy Orton, against whoever steps up and becomes champion. He's just that good.
Wow. Absolutely. Well, Mark, you know, you are incredible inside of the ring, but you also do a lot outside of the ring to help others. Last weekend, you were a part of the Reclaiming You Sports event that involved some other WWE superstars. Can you tell us a little bit about that experience and what were you able to help accomplish with that?
You know what? It was really cool to join in with the PCA and the Mark Henry Strong Kids. We wanted to work together to do something that can help kids who have been inside and not getting to do workouts and compete in sports during the summer. So, you know, that was my thought process in putting that together. I used my resources to reach out to people and ask for favors. And I had so many people that stepped up and helped me that I really appreciate them all. The WWE, as being a sponsor of the event, I thank them from the bottom of my heart because 100% that was not for me. It wasn't for my ego. It was for those kids, and I'm going to continue to do so. I thought that everybody that came on from the WWE did a great job, and you're well-respected and well-appreciated.
Well, we really appreciate you putting in the work to do that and to help. And to help others. And before we let you go, Jacob and Joanna, with your dad standing here right next to you, besides him, he's obviously your favorite WWE superstar of all time. Who are some of your other favorite superstars?
My favorite women's wrestlers is Bianca Belair, Charlotte Flair, yes. Becky Lynch. Okay. And then my favorite male superstars would have to be Keith Lee, Finn Balor, Seth Rollins, Monday Night Messiah.
I know who JoJo's favorite is.
I love Sasha, Bianca, Naomi. I mean, those are my three favorite superstars.
Are you worried about Sasha against Asuka tonight at SummerSlam?
I am kind of worried, but I have a feeling she got this.
Okay. Well, guys, thank you so, so much for joining us here on The Bump. What do you have there? Oh, look at there.
Ready to go. Hey. Oh, there you go. The Barbie. I like it.
Yes. But seriously, you guys are so much fun. Big personalities in the two of you. I'm looking forward to seeing more out of you, Jacob and Joanna. Mark Henry, it's always such a pleasure. You guys enjoy watching SummerSlam with your Welch's grape juice. And we hope to get you back here on The Bump soon.
Thanks, everybody.
Jacob.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys. Happy SummerSlam. All right. Jacob and Joanna are going to have some entertaining careers of their own. They completely stole that interview. Sorry, Mark. Well, it is now time for the number three SummerSlam moment chosen by the WWE Universe in our SummerSlam segment presented by Cricket Wireless and World of Tanks.
The clothesline by Brock Lesnar. Now that's brought down.
Go high, bro.
And the champion, Brock Lesnar with a DDT. The Animal with a weapon in hand.
He don't need a weapon. His hands are
gone. Into the ribs. The injured ribs of a rock. Oh, the rock exploding out of the corner.
Never say die attitude of the rock.
The promo pole digging deep down. The right hand to the challenger.
Oh,
back down, and Lesnar.
Brock hop in front of the chair.
I wish I was in the crowd for that. We thank Matt for sending in that tweet. Let's see what he said. He sent in his pick. Here we go. Matt M. Dog. Back in 2002. It's crazy to think that was almost 20 years ago.
It is wild.
Wow. But guys, reactions. I know Ryan, which is dancing in his chair. Matt Gamp, do you feel like this was a proper pick for the top four?
Personally, this is my number one because this is the greatest rookie year of all time. You heard Tony Chimble say when he announced Brock as the new champion, Chimble! The next big thing, he was. There was no more next after that. He was. And I'll tell you what, I know The Rock has often been a fan favorite. That night in Long Island, those fans wanted to see Brock Lesnar become champion. It's one of my favorite crowd reactions. The Rock is kind of taken aback. He takes it in stride. A moment, and my favorite SummerSlam, by the way, SummerSlam 2002.
Well, let's talk about some more matches happening tonight. Ryan, I'm going to come straight to you because I know you have a very invested interest in a couple of these matches, starting with the SmackDown Women's Championship match between Bayley and Asuka.
Well, I am glad, generally speaking, that you guys are here with me all the time, especially today. Captain Kayla, I'm picking Bayley tonight, which may be a shock to some.
No way!
Yeah, what? No, I'm going with Bayley in this one. But do you guys want to know why I'm going with Bayley tonight? You want to take a guess, Evan? Want to take a guess as to why? I'm going with Bayley tonight because of you and because of Matt Camp and because of Kayla Braxton for irritating Bayley for the last not just month, but multiple months. She's going to make Asuka pay tonight. She's going to make you guys pay tonight. Give me Bayley and a runaway tonight. So you see that disrespect on the screen? It's Asuka's fault. It's your guys' fault. Give me Bayley. Give me Bayley tonight. Give me Bayley 10 times over tonight. Thank you. Thank you. Go on. I'm happy to be here with you guys, though. Go on.
Camp, take this away from him, please.
You got it. No problem. Last time we will share an opinion probably for the rest of the show, and certainly not on this. Asuka's very, very, very angry. Kairi Sane is not here anymore, and that's because of Bayley and because of Sasha Banks. Oh, and that night, by the way, she lost her Raw Women's Championship. This is step one of Asuka takes it all back. This is step one. She won and earned that opportunity by winning the Battle Royal. She will win her first of two championships when she ends the historic reign of Bayley tonight.
Asuka, two belts. That is all.
Really, just.
Okay, well, Team Matt, throwing it right back at you. Let's talk about the Raw Women's Championship. Again, Asuka and Miss Sasha Banks. You just said what you felt, but you want to rub it in a little bit more.
Make it official, Evan. Go ahead. Double down, Evan. Go ahead.
Listen, in all seriousness, man, if Asuka wins one out of these two belts, it will be an amazing thing. You know, if she beats Sasha Banks, it'll be incredible. It'll make Ryan salty, and that makes me oh so joyous. But if she just gets one done, that's all she needs. So Asuka winning the belt tonight, or the title tonight, will be extraordinary. So I have to give her at least one in all seriousness. You know I'm being facetious.
He's already wavering
a little bit. In all seriousness, I give her one title.
Not if. When she wins both championships. When she wins both championships. When Sasha is mad that she lost. And then both of them are just going, well, what do we do now? We're just role models. I mean, I wouldn't follow a role model who has no gold. They'll still have the women's tag team championships. But then, you know, payback's coming up. If it's not Asuka, you know, I think Shayna Baszler's looking down at Sasha as well. So Sasha's in trouble no matter what. I don't know. It's going to be a rough 8 days probably for Sasha Banks and Asuka. Excuse me, Sasha Banks and Bayley, because Asuka's getting two pieces of gold. Coming her way tonight.
Is it my turn?
Unfortunately.
It's your turn.
Go ahead, Pat.
I'm picking Sasha Banks in the Raw Women's Championship match. And you want to know why I'm picking Sasha Banks in the Raw Women's Championship match?
Why?
It's not because of you three. It's because that Sasha Banks is the best wrestler on planet Earth. And that's what you do when you're the best wrestler on planet Earth. You defeat Asuka at SummerSlam with all the odds and all the pundits, not me, you guys, against her. Sasha Banks, I didn't freestyle about Sasha Banks on Twitter because I thought she was losing, Kayla. Give me Sasha Banks tonight 100 times over every day for the rest of time.
You can do a loser song for her, too. That'd be great.
Listen, as soon as we're done filming, taping today, and this airs, and everything is said and done after SummerSlam, Ryan, I'm going to get this care package in the mail to you because you might actually need it. So get your little blanket and whatever else you might
need. Chicken noodle soup!
Okay, let's talk about the United States Championship match. This is a match that I really have my eye on. We've got Apollo Crews and MVP. Evan, do you think MVP, after all his talking, is going to walk away tonight as the new United States Champion?
You know, it's interesting, KBO Brack, Stone Queen B. It's very interesting, man, growing up and watching MVP in my youth and seeing him. And then we fast forward to 2020 SummerSlam, and he's still able to go pillar to post, collar and elbow. And young Evan's like, man, I would love to see MVP get that title. But Apollo has just been put through a lot. He's come a long way. He's the best he's ever been at this moment. I don't think he's going to lose tonight. So I will give the nod to Apollo Crews. Young Mac loves your MVP, Young Mac, but I'm not Young Mac anymore, man. I've grown. I've changed.
You're an adult, except for when you pick.
Pat?
And we're all raw when title matches. Fine, whatever. Listen, I love Apollo Crews. I love him. I love watching him. And the Hurt Business has made so many statements in recent weeks, and I'm torn on this one too, if I'm being quite honest. I lean towards Apollo Crews, although I do have pause, but I think the variables or the lack thereof at ringside tonight will make a difference. I'm volleying back and forth yet again today, but give me Apollo Crews.
We do have two gentlemen standing by who probably don't appreciate everything that was just said here. So without further ado, please welcome on 2/3 of the Hurt Business, Bobby Lashley and Shelton Benjamin.
Hey, thanks for having us.
And yes, thanks.
a little bird told me that someone actually said that MVP has no chance of winning tonight. First of all, is that any way to welcome us to the show with an insult? I mean, with jokes, with straight up jokes. Because you have to be kidding me if you really think the MVP is not going to beat Apollo within an inch of his life tonight. This is what we do. This is why we're called the Hurt Business. And I like to think of it as youthful ignorance. That's what's going on right now. If you actually think that Apollo stands a chance against the crafty, the veteran, I mean, the genius that is MVP. I mean, come on, guys.
Well, where is MVP? Why is he with you guys today? Is he just trying to get in the right mindset ahead of his match?
Well, absolutely. I mean, he understands it. Yeah, I mean, today is a big day for MVP. I mean, he has a chance to regain the U.S. championship, all right? So he's got no time for interviews. It's about business. You know, it's game day. MVP is in training. He's in the combine. He's preparing for battle. That's what's going on with MVP.
And how important is it for, you know, the Hurt Business as a whole to bring home the gold tonight?
It's extremely important. I mean, I believe the Hurt Business is what's needed around here. You know, you can't have a good guy without a quality bad guy, and that's what the Hurt Business is about. We're bringing out some old school back to these new school kids and beating them up. And I think this kind of legitimizes us. We pose a threat to everyone. Everyone. If you think about it, Apollo's just the first one. We pose a threat to Drew. We pose a threat to the tag team divisions. And we pose a threat to anyone, including Brock. Right, Sheldon? Everyone.
Any and everyone. Everybody's a target.
Wow.
So this is just another notch for us. We're going to take this title, and then we're going to go on to many, many more.
That's totally fair. And as you kind of touched on there, Bobby, you guys have been through MVP's side through all of this with Apollo over recent weeks and months. Does you guys being banned from ringside tonight affect MVP's strategy at all, or does it affect any part of the match in your guys' opinion?
I mean, in my opinion, it doesn't affect anything. MVP is more than capable of dispatching Apollo on his own. You know, if we're there, I mean, the only reason we would even be there is for moral support. MVP doesn't need our help to beat Apollo. I mean, and that's what most of you people, and I guess apparently some people, you know, that work for the bump don't realize that MVP can get the job done all on his own. We're just there. We would have just been there for moral support.
Now, MVP does seem pretty confident. He talked about it with me on Raw Talk on Monday night that he thinks that Apollo might be behind Retribution. Heading in tonight, do you guys still stand by that claim, or do you think maybe it's just a distraction from the task at hand?
I think he has a point there. I mean, because there's no other reason why Apollo should be so confident coming into this. I mean, we've all beat him up. I beat him up, Shelton beat him up, and MVP's beat him up. And for him to come out here so confident every week, I'm like, where is he getting this confidence from? Does he have some kind of rabbit in his hat, something up his sleeve? There's got to be something. So possibly this little Retribution might have his back. And if the Retribution has his back, the Retribution can get beat up the same way Apollo will be.
And that was basically what I was going to ask. Yeah, like if Retribution bumps into you guys tonight, what should they expect? So they should expect to get beat up.
Kayla, let me reiterate what Bobby said earlier. Everybody's a target. If Retribution want to get some, Retribution can get some. Apollo's going to get plenty tonight. So we don't back down from Retribution or any other group of guys who think they can take on the Hurt Business. We are legit badasses, and we will prove it every week.
It's fair.
Bring the bats, too. Bring the bats. I'm watching these videos of these guys running around with bats. Bring the bats, too. It really doesn't matter. I'll beat these dudes up by myself. You guys can join me if you want to, but I'll go looking for them. I think we should just go looking for this Retribution after we beat up Apollo, because they're creating this huge buzz around. Everybody's talking about Retribution. I don't know what they're about. I don't know who's behind it. We're not afraid. We don't run behind masks like these guys do. If these guys are so legit, take off the mask and meet us in the ring. We're not scared of anyone.
I believe that's what you call a statement, for sure. Shelton, I want to switch gears a little bit because the 24/7 title has been your primary focus as of late. Now, things can sometimes get wacky with the 24/7 title. Everybody knows it and everybody loves it. But what I've seen is something a little bit different when with your reigns as 24/7 champ. Are you looking to bring a certain legitimacy to that title and basically say to anyone, come fight me 24/7?
Okay, I'll put it to you this way. The 24/7 championship does not have the respect that it deserves. Why? Poor representation. All right. You got guys running around, hiding in trash cans, you know, hiding under cars and sneaking up behind each other. I'm not running from anybody. I'm not going to sneak up behind anybody. If you want the 24/7 championship title, you know what? I'll wait for you. I'll be in the ring. You don't have to sneak around. No one is going to just come take it from me. No one's going to sneak up behind me. Cedric Alexander found out firsthand that running around and sneaking stuff, that's not going to fly with me, because I can do it just as well as any, but I choose to stand like a champion. I'm going to legitimize this belt. It's been used as, it's been a joke, all right? It's been a gag. I'm not here to play, all right? I'm a serious competitor, and I take championships very seriously, and that includes the 24/7 championship. So I am definitely not going to be your Benny Hill skit of a champion, all right?
I totally get that and respect it. You mentioned Cedric's name there. Obviously, you guys have been going back and forth over 24/7 title, and he's currently standing by Apollo Crews as you guys have kind of been engulfed in this battle. MVP, though, has made offers to Cedric to join the Hurt Business. From your guys' perspective, do those offers still stand as of right now?
I like Cedric, man. I think we can influence Shelton and Cedric in a very positive way. I think Cedric can be our little bully if he chooses to be, but this is not something that we're going to keep offering these guys, because it's ridiculous that we talked to him for the first time and he didn't jump into it. That's just bad planning. That's bad decision making. Why is he getting all this on me? That's what happens. I think we'll give him one more opportunity and see what he does with it. Maybe Cedric has it in his heart to be a champion. If he does, he'll accept the offer.
Fair.
Man, I like this. I like that kid, man. I really like Cedric, man. I said that for a long time. It's not an idle offer. It's a serious offer. I like Cedric, man. I like that kid. I think that we have what he needs. Cedric is... And you said it several times, he's a great entertainer, great performer, but he just needs to get a little bit of grit. He needs to get a little mean. He needs to get a little bit of, I want to hurt somebody, because if he wants to hurt somebody, man, we can walk him to whatever championship he wants to get to. I think that's what we're really about. That's the business side of what we're trying to do. And that's what MVP tried to say. As soon as he came on with me, we started talking, we're in championship matches all the way across the board. And I think Cedric needs somebody like us. So, I mean, this is something that I don't know if it's something that we just throw out there and throw away. I think it's something that we kind of persuade him and tell him that, look, this is what you need to do for your career. Listen to us and be a bullet. Join the Hurt Business.
Wow. So yeah, you guys clearly like Cedric. But Bobby, I'm gonna say a name of someone that you probably don't really like, and that is Lana. It seems like, you know, it's been ages since your relationship ended, but it's only actually been a few months. I apologize for bringing her name up, but I have a point. Your last shot at the WWE title, Lana got involved. You ended up coming up short. But the question is, now that you're in this entirely new role, do you think that you would want or possibly even deserve another opportunity at the WWE title in the near future?
I think absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, like I told you before, we pose a threat for everyone. And I think we're a huge threat for Mr. Drew McIntyre. I think everybody has an opportunity to get beat by the three of us, because neither one of us, not Shelton, MVP, or myself, none of us, we're not slouches. We're out there, and I think all of us have the possibility of winning any title in the business right now. I think Drew is on his path. He has his hands full with Randy, but I think after that, I think I want a shot at one of those guys. And as for Lana, there's no bad blood. I mean, we went our separate ways. We had our little run together where people hated us and loved us for whatever reason they did. But, you know, we had the title. I don't want to say it's her fault. She was there. She got emotional. So Drew took advantage of it. I think that's the one thing that he needs to address. He took advantage of that, and then he walked away with the title, and he told me that I don't get a shot again. So that's why we kind of took a step back and work with the Hurt Business, beat some people up, and then when it's time to go after Drew again, we'll get our opportunity.
Well, let's stay on the topic of matches, because Raw Underground has debuted on Raw a few weeks ago, and the first night of Raw Underground got rather lively. You guys arrived at the end of the night, and as best I can put it, just totally wrecked all human life that came in front of you. Bobby, I want to start with you. Raw Underground is going strong, and if you guys were ever venture back there, is there anyone you'd want to face in Raw Underground?
I think there's a lot of guys. You know who I thought looked pretty tough, even though he lost last week? I thought Eric was looking pretty doggone tough.
Oh, yeah. Right.
I think Dolph is looking incredibly tough also. I started around the same time Dolph did. And me and Dolph kind of had some wrestling matches here and there, some little amateur matches. So I think Dolph would be fun. I like Eric because Eric looks like he's aggressive. But I think somebody that everybody kind of forgot about a little bit is Alistair. I think Alistair has some legit skills, and I think Alistair would be somebody that'd be fun to go in there and mix it up with.
That'd be wild.
All right, Shelton, we're going to bring that question to you. What about you if you could face someone at Raw Underground?
I got to be honest with you. Like, I have such a high opinion of myself when it comes to that kind of fighting that my attitude is just line them up. Alistair, I think he'd be a lot of fun to fight. Eric of the Viking Raiders, I mean, he is as tough as nails, and I think it'd be fun just to have a nice old-fashioned brawl with him. But yeah, I mean, to be honest, nobody impresses me. I mean, the toughest person that I've seen on Raw Underground, aside from myself, would be Bobby, and we're working together, so. You know, I'd rather have that beast on my side.
That's fair. Bobby, a few weeks ago on Raw, there was what looked like, I don't know how long of a conversation, but a conversation between you, MVP, and Ron Simmons. Can you give us any insight to what you guys were talking about that night?
Not really.
Fair enough. I had to ask.
That's privileged information.
You know, sometimes in the wrestling business, you go back to some of the people that you watched and ask for advice. And when Ron came, we asked him for a little bit of advice. We had a little rap session. Nothing too important, just something between us, between friends.
Fair. Shelton, on the topic of the Hurt Business, it looked like Mia Yim was curious about getting in, and like obviously everybody knows about your dynamic with her. Is there an avenue? We saw this play out on social media. Is there an avenue for her to join the group? Is that possible?
Okay, you know, we were having such a nice, enjoyable interview here, and then you had to bring up the M word.
Oh wow!
First of all,
sorry.
Apologies. She is a phenomenal talent, and I mean, she would fit in great with the Hurt Business. And let's not make no mistake, the Hurt Business, we're not limited to just male members. So we're very much looking at the female talent in WWE also. Mia Yim has definitely been talked about, but right now, no. Application denied.
Wow.
I was interested to hear the outcome of this.
But actually, let me roll back on that. If she can acquire us the services of one Keith Lee, then hey, now we're talking about a party. Because, you know, if Keith wanted her in and we allow him in, I guess she could get in through a backdoor deal, but no.
You can make an exception at that point.
No. We'll make an exception at that point.
Is he still shaking hands and kissing babies over there? Because if he is, we're not about that.
Seems like you two need to get on the same page as far as who's allowed in and who's not.
The business, we have meetings. I mean, you know, and we work it out. Like, that's why we call it. That's why it's a business.
It's how it works. It makes sense.
That's how it works.
How business works.
All right, well, let's talk about what's happening tonight. And this is my final question to you. Let's say MVP walks out of the Thunderdome tonight at SummerSlam as the new United States champion. What is next for the Hurt Business?
We're going to celebrate. The VIP lounge, we're going to celebrate. Hey, but you know what? I think there's one thing, like I said before, we pose a threat to everyone. And I think our tag team division is a little suspect. I think these guys have been like shaking hands and dancing with each other and playing with each other and everything like that. I think we need to go and shake that up. Now we have three of us. Any two of us stepping into that division is going to be a huge threat. So it could be Shelton and I. It could be MVP and Shelton. We have a lot of different options. But I think we are going to kind of look at those titles and see if that division is even worthy.
Wow. All right.
That's next.
Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us here on The Bump. Please give MVP our best. I definitely wish him all the best. I did not say those things like my co-host said earlier. And again, yeah, we appreciate you guys taking the time out to chat with us here today.
Thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
They didn't seem too happy with you guys after what you said about MVP's match tonight.
That's not what I took away from that, Kayla. They seemed thrilled.
That's what I took away. I took away. Well, guys, we are down to our final two favorite SummerSlam moments chosen by you, the WWE Universe. So here is our second most favorite SummerSlam moment in our SummerSlam segment presented by Cricket Wireless and World of Tanks.
The following contest for one fall is for the WWE Championship.
This is no low gear for Daniel Bryan, is it? No, they're in. But he who hesitates is lost. He drives it like he stole it. And this is what I was talking about. This is what Cena had to stay away from. And look at this. Cena from out of nowhere. From out of the Bryan kicked out. Cena down in the corner. Daniel Bryan third time. Right into a wicked clothesline. What a freaking clothesline.
A wicked clothesline by Cena.
Daniel Bryan turned to 360. Bryan up over the top. Cena caught him. Can he get that attitude of judgment? No!
He's on the side of the counter by Bryan.
Daniel Bryan up on the shoulders. Going to the AA. Bryan.
Universe love this.
SummerSlam moment was chosen by our pal Nate.
The Nature Boy.
Nathan. All right. So, Ryan, let's start with you. What are your thoughts on the SummerSlam moment?
KB, I'm on record saying that Bret and Owen in the cage is the greatest SummerSlam match of all time. But, man, this one's darn close. It's just darn close. There's just so, I mean, by the way, great call by Michael Cole there with that. What a friggin' clothesline. That was amazing in and of itself. But just, there's that match had so much build and so much anticipation. It's the perfect example of a match living up to the hype and far exceeding it. I'm personally not a fan of what Randy Orton and Triple H did after the fact, but good on them for pulling it off. But that started, in a lot of ways, like Becky earlier, we're talking about that. That really started Daniel Bryan's climb, as much of a negative as it ended up being. Towards becoming a champion at WrestleMania 30.
Man, that match really resonates with me a lot because it's my wife's first pay-per-view of her entire life. And I took her there. It was in L.A. And I was like, man, I hope we get a good show, man. It's not like we don't get a good show. But I really want her to be introduced to why I love this so much. And that happened. And I never forget her face. She's like, what? He's that? Who's champion? What happened? I thought he was champ. But what? Hey, I said, hey, man, it's WWE, man. Anything can happen, man. You got to see her. And her favorite wrestler of all time when she was growing up was Triple H. He came out, shocked the world. Everyone was booing, but she was cheering. It was an amazing thing. And that SummerSlam moment always means so much to me because to see her face and her shock just like literally just encompasses what WWE is all about.
All right, well, here to help us break down the matches that are taking place tonight at SummerSlam. You'll never see it coming. Give it up for Kensale Blumen.
Yeah.
Kensale!
Beautiful, how are you?
Hello, everybody. How are you? I'm really, really fine and happy to be here with you guys. Thank you so much.
100%.
We are so excited you are here with us. It's been a while since I feel like I've seen you in person. So first off, I'm going to ask you, how have you been?
Actually, great. Now with everything, working too much and creating new ideas. And yes, everything is really fine, actually. Busy, busy, busy.
talk to us great. A little bit about your show streaming today, La Previa, coming up today, and give us details on the SummerSlam preview show.
Wow. Well, actually, this is the second time. This is our second, the second time that we are doing this. And La Previa basically is the show that you have to see. Because we will talk about the hottest topics in WWE. For example, Dominic Mysterio versus Seth Rollins in the street fight. So for us, we have a lot of things to talk. And I'm with Marcelo Rodriguez, that he's an amazing friend. Colleague, and I have to say, it's kind of a mentor as well. And we have a really amazing and special guest. For example, for SummerSlam, we have Bianca Belair, we have Charlotte Flair, we have Andrade, Angel Garza as well, Zelina Vega, Paige. So imagine with all those amazing superstars, in Mexico we say we're going to echar el chal. So it's kind of to gossip, right? So, and having a great moments with them. So, yeah, basically it's having fun and, yeah, it's really nice.
That sounds awesome. You mentioned the Mysterios in that answer, and obviously a big night for them tonight at SummerSlam. Last month at a horror show at WWE Extreme Rules, Rey Mysterio obviously had the result that he had in the Eye for an Eye match. Rey Mysterio is a lucha legend and icon. What was the reaction to that, you know, where you are seeing what Rey went through?
Well, actually, we had another show on Thursday that the name is Seth Brunch. So Seth Rollins was there, and he talked about that incident. And he said that sometimes you need to go through difficult moments just to realize that you have to go on the good path. Because, you know, it's the Messiah. So he was 100% sure about Rey Mysterio needs that terrible thing, because I have to say it, it was a really terrible thing for everyone.
Now, do we think that, you know, Dominic has maybe extra pressure on him tonight? Because he's not only facing a former world champion, but he also kind of has it on his shoulders to carry on that Mysterio dynasty.
Yes. I mean, my God, of course it's a lot of pressure. But I think we need to switch to think about that thing, because Dominic, he showed that he has everything to face someone like Seth Rollins. And I'm completely sure that he has everything, because, oh my God, I didn't know that he had that ability with the kendo stick. And of course, as well, imagine that your father is Rey Mysterio and he's supporting you and he's covering your back. My God, he had everything just to show to the people and say, like, yes, I'm the next one and I will be a really, really great in the legacy of Mysterio. So I think it's something huge for him. But at the same moment, I have to confess that I'm a little bit nervous, because it's a street fight and it's not with someone like random. It's Seth Rollins. So, but I think he had the courage and he has someone like Rey Mysterio. So yes, I'm very happy about this.
Wow. So we just had Andrade, Angel Garza, and Zelina, and they have a big match tonight challenging the Street Profits for the Raw Tag Team Championships. This has obviously gotten very personal with Zelina. She's poisoning Montez. Do you think her actions have taken the focus away from her clients, from them trying to become champions?
Of course. Zelina, well, for me, she's really smart. She's a really smart girl. She's showing us how to be a manager, right? And distracting the opponents just to give the her clients a bigger chance for this match. But as well, at the same time, I think they don't need an extra help. Andrade and Garza, for me, they are awesome. And it's not just because I'm a Latina. It's because I really love the technique. I think they're wonderful in the ring. And at the same time, I think Andrade and Garza together is kind of the spark and the fire. And this is the formula that we need to get these titles in Latin America. Sorry, is it true?
Spark in the fire.
Oh, man. This is going so well.
Kayla's got some issues with that crew, but neither here nor there.
Well, listen, we want to have a little fun with you before we let you go. We always have fun here on The Bump. So this is what we're going to do. I know you're prepared for this. So we're going to have you give us some wrestling terms in your native language of Spanish, and we are going to try to guess what they are in English. So I know you have these terms ready, right? Okay. So,
ready to rumble. Yeah.
Yes.
The first one is el francotirador.
Well.
What?
Come on, guys.
One time in Spanish class in 10th grade, we talked about sports entertainment. I think it's sharpshooter.
How you get that, Pat?
How do you know that?
Am I right?
Yes.
I might be the only one.
Okay.
You snarling.
Next one. El Mesías. This is an easy one. Super easy.
One more time, please.
El Mesías.
The Messiah.
Yes. Good.
Oh,
Taylor, you're really good at this.
Yes.
I was thinking the mat.
She's a Mexican. She's a Mexican girl. I know. I knew it.
There, see? There we go.
Okay. Wow. The next one is very easy and simple, and it's going to be fast. El pedigree.
Pedigree.
For the pedigree.
Yeah.
Pedigree.
Oh.
Yeah. Next one is Fondo del Abismo Rocalloso.
One more time, please.
El Fondo del Abismo Rocalloso.
Thunderdome. No? I heard thunder.
No.
Welcome to the Thunderdome.
No. Come on. It's yours. Now it's your turn. Venga.
It's Ali, I don't know.
I felt good about thunder.
One more time.
Okay.
El Fondo del Abismo Rocalloso.
Kayla, what are you doing? What are you doing?
That's how I think.
Are you trying to will the answer?
I've been on the show with you 10 months. I'm just seeing you doing this all of a sudden. I do not know.
Okay. Well, I'm going to give you another shot with the next one. Okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Estrella Fugaz.
Test of strength. Oh, darn. I felt good about that, too.
Come on, guys. It's something like Star.
Shooting Star Press.
Lucha. Oh, no, because that's the... Wait, was I right? Was I there?
You got it.
Shooting Star Press. Oh! No, Kayla, I got it.
Yeah, Ryan got it. Well,
listen,
I think we need to stop with this activity because, of course, I win. So,
you won for sure. Yeah.
Oh, you definitely won.
And listen, next time you come on the bump, we're going to make sure we're way more brushed up on our Spanish terms. But we do appreciate the little education there.
I'm going to translator sites right now.
I know. Thank you so much for joining us here in the bump. You're so much fun. You're welcome anytime. And I know you will be watching along with us as to what happens tonight. SummerSlam, you'll never see it, Kevin. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you
so much, guys.
Appreciate
Thank you so much. I hope to see you soon as well.
All right, guys. Well, it is now time for our number one SummerSlam moment chosen by you in our SummerSlam segment presented by Cricket Wireless and World of Ticks.
This last match, March 29th, 1998. We are witnessing something that we, quite frankly, thought we'd never see.
This match is not sanctioned by the WWE. The showstopper, the cerebral assassin.
That is bad. No, God!
DDT on that steel chair. Oh, Shawn Michaels busted open. Oh, no. Hear music! Look out! Oh, God! Don't do it! Don't do it! For the superplex! God, the carnage! Oh, fans! He still got it, JR! They're tuning up that band! Bang! No! It's blocked! I thought he had it! It was blocked!
Oh, no!
Evergreen! My God, it's
him! No!
Oh, Michaels, roll up! Will it be? Can it be? Prevailing!
Oh, my God!
God almighty! That hammer away! No! I don't want! No!
After one of the most awesome performances I've ever seen in 25 years, for it to end like this, with the hands of Triple H, he's gonna rot in hell for what he did here tonight.
All right. Worthy of being in that number one spot. Thanks so much to Nimesh. You went to Twitter and gave us that moment. There you go.
Nimesh!
Yeah, back in 2000. The match. All right. Matt Camp, starting with you.
Well, first of all, once again, it's the greatest SummerSlam of all time, 2002. But 4+ years, Shawn Michaels out of the ring after he lost the championship to Stone Cold at WrestleMania. And then he comes back in jeans and boots, and he beats Triple H, and it was like he never missed a step. It started the next chapter of a Hall of Fame career for Shawn Michaels. He was a Hall of Famer already, but to come back like he did, not only for that match, he wins the World Heavyweight Championship, he's back in WrestleMania main events, but to come back after 4+ years and put on that kind of performance is why he is the showstopper.
Oh, hard to argue, man. Old top 10 versus top 5 is what I call that. You know what I mean? Two of my favorite to ever do it in the ring. There were so many things on the line, non-sanctioned match. And just to see Triple H and Shawn Michaels and the ebbs and flows and the peaks and valleys of their relationship throughout their careers, man, and then culminating in that moment in Matt Kemp's opinion, the greatest SummerSlam of all time. Hard to argue with that young man is saying over there, Matt Kemp is hard. You know what, Matt? It is the greatest SummerSlam of all time. And it was just, you know what? Like, what you've been saying it all show, and I'm like, he's right. This dude is right. It is the greatest SummerSlam of all time, and that is one of the greatest matches of all time, and I cannot argue with Mr. Nemesh.
And yeah, for me, like at the Ponus Ridge Middle School lunch table, Shawn Michaels was the coolest guy around. So me, Sheldon, Winston, John Lubin, we're thinking there's no way we're ever going to see Shawn Michaels again, right? And then everything Matt says, he comes out. To me, the most telling moment of that amazing match, though, is that image of Shawn just lounging on the top rope while Triple H is coming out. Because you know what that symbolized? That Shawn Michaels, even with 4 years away, even with all the question marks, even with the back, still knew that he was one of, if not the very best to ever do it, and had no worries in the world. And they had an all-time classic that, for me and my friends, was unthinkable to think we'd ever see. We got it, and it was amazing.
Truth.
All right. Well, thanks, guys, and thanks to all of you who submitted your top SummerSlam moments. But, guys, before we go, we still have a big bump episode in store on Wednesday. So why don't we let you guys know who's going to be joining us. You ready?
I like this part. Yeah,
hit me the drum roll, please.
Who? Man, this never gets old. A wrestling god.
So you get the whole entrance like you did on Raw with all the pyro and everything? Wow.
But guys, that's not it.
There's more, Captain?
Not all who's joining us. There's more.
Oh, nice.
Okay.
Man, I'm gonna eat so much turkey on Wednesday.
So much turkey.
Big
drum. I want a turkey leg. Okay, and...
There's more?
Tonight... Well, I want to talk about tonight. Watch Along will be going down per usual for every pay-per-view featuring your favorite superstars and our lovely bump cast. So let's talk about who's going to be joining us tonight.
Look at this program. Look at this program. You are going to see all these wonderful people on Watch Along tonight. Social media, all of WWE. Is that Cardigan? Oh, no, it's Malcolm Bivens there. JBL, hey, we're going to get him twice. Xavier Woods, Matt Riddle, Renee Young. Lovely to talk to
Max
her.
Woods.
There's Jinder Mahal, Casey Catanzaro, Kate Carter. That's a loaded group. Join us tonight, 7 p.m. Eastern. Watch Along, WWE Watch Along. Watch it with us on all of WWE's social media.
Please, we have fun.
Please. And guys, thank you all for joining us today for our special SummerSlam episode of The Bump, which will emanate from the WWE Thunderdome.
Thunderdome was wild on Friday. Thunderdome was wild on Friday.
On social media, let us know what you're most excited to see. React with us after each match. And yes, I know, for one, this is going to be one intense SummerSlam. We can all agree.
Yes.
You'll never see it coming.
Brexto!
The only thing we'll know.
Watch along.
The only thing we'll see coming is Bayley and Sasha. And still. All right. See you guys. Happy SummerSlam. It's going to be great.
Full credit.
It's going to be great.
Credit.
See you at Watch Along. Going to be gonna have fun. Going to have fun.
I was born a champion. Got the heart of a winner. And I'm never give up. No, I'm never surrender. I'm a winner.